everybody. It's Bria Stevens from Live Laugh Law.
Hey everyone, it's Attorney Jasmine Robinson of Jazz Talks Law.
And we are back with part two of what it is like to be a black woman in the legal profession. The next issue that we want to address is finding fellow black women within the firm, the organization, the school that you are at.
So it's very important for you to identify who those fellow black women attorneys are, what have you, because as we've been discussing so far, those are the people that are going to understand where you're coming from. And being that, for example, if they're a partner at the firm, they've been there for a while, so they can be possibly your mentor or your go-to person to help you work through some things, if you will. So identify those persons. Before I started law school, I joined a middle-sized firm in downtown Atlanta. And the black female partner, she was so helpful to me. We understood each other. We got each other. We would talk about work, but we would also talk about things outside of work. She would take me to lunch and just give me the inside information that I needed to know in regards to that firm.
Yes, and so me being at school, I do have my group of girls that I go to ask anything about law school. And I think it's very important to have that, because it's like, honestly, it's a comfort zone, and you need that no matter if you're at school or if you're at work. So that's something very important to have. It's just that the person that looks like you that you can go and talk to, because they're the ones that are going to be honest with you.
Absolutely. So the next thing that we wanted to discuss was befriending your non-black classmates and coworkers.
Yes, so I actually had a very good experience with befriending non-black student this past week. So we had oral arguments, as I told you all, and the person who I was going against in oral arguments was a white male. And I reached out to him, and we had we prepared for our oral argument 2 days in a row. And he was honestly the most helpful person. And had I been afraid to, you know, reach out to him because he was a white male, I probably would not have done as well in my oral argument. So it's very important to befriend those people. And they might have events going on that you don't know about, or they might have an outline that you don't know about. For example, we had two different professors, me and this guy did. But we were arguing against each other. So he had a list of possible questions from his professor, and I had a list of possible questions from my professor, and we were able to share that, and it just expanded our horizons so much more because we were working together.
Most definitely. It's so important to get to know people outside of those that look like you. Once you enter the legal profession, you're going to be one in a sea of many. So you can't just be comfortable around those that look like you. You have to start to make those connections outside of your race or background.
Yes, and so Jazz said one in the sea of many. And that's actually the next thing that we were going to talk about, being the only one in the room. Mm-hmm. It happens so often, y'all. But you just have to be comfortable with yourself. Learn how to sell yourself independent of what everyone else has going on in the room. You are you, and you're in this room for a reason.
Yes.
So show them why you're here, why you are the only one in the room. Just make yourself stand out, because you're already standing out, but make yourself stand out in a positive way.
And to add to that, you have to realize that you belong there, as she stated, but to dive into that a little further, you have to be confident. You have to walk in the room and say, hello, I'm Jasmine Robinson. I'm a law school coach for Jazz Talks Law. Who are you? You know, like, really be willing to walk up to someone and be confident about what you have to offer, knowing that there's something in value that they could explore. So just be confident in yourself, whether you're in the classroom, whether you're at a legal networking event, whether you're visiting law school. So just a quick example of this. I was working with one of my students. We went to visit a law school, and when we got there, we were all excited. You know, I was happy to show her around, what have you. And she's a very bright, bubbly, well-rounded individual. But as soon as we got inside and we met with the admissions team, her personality kind of just went out the door. Like, she became this quiet person who just seemed scared and nervous and shy. And we talked about it afterwards, and it come to find out she didn't really feel as confident in herself as she should have. And I told her, I said, listen, you have a lot to offer this school. You have to remember that. You have to go in there and own it. You are a walking application. something you say or do during your tour of the school could stand out in their mind. And then they might say, let me go pull her application file. Even though she doesn't have the LSAT that we normally require, you know what? I really like her. I really want to give her a shot. Mm-hmm. So never, ever let anyone ever dim your light.
The next issue is that we want to explore is fitting in with the majority.
This is something that I struggle with, you guys, to be very honest. It can be a little intimidating when you are in a room filled with people that just look nothing like you and you don't know if they understand your background or appreciate your background. It can definitely be a little intimidating. I think we discussed this a little in part one, but it goes back to knowing that you belong there. They didn't accept you to that law school for any reason. You weren't invited to that networking event for any reason. It's just taking advantage of the opportunities that comes your way, even if you feel like you are in a room full of the majority and you don't know they even like that you're there.
And one thing that you can do to like help yourself fit in, or if you're worried about fitting in, is just talk about something that you know everybody likes. So I know it was like the day after the Super Bowl. We're here in Atlanta. Atlanta lost. Yep. And I was in a room with a bunch of the majority, and I was the only one in the room. So what did we talk about? We talked about the Falcons loss, and I had watched the game, so it was easy to, you know, talk to them about that. I also enjoy basketball. I'm in love with LeBron James. So, you know, most males watch basketball. So that's something, you know, easy to talk about. So just find, you know, something that, you know, will be of common interest. But don't go in there and act like you know everything about basketball and start like listing players. And then they're like, oh, this player. And then you don't know that player, or talk about a game that you didn't even watch. That's too far, because then they're going to start to see that you don't really know this, and you're going to end up making yourself look stand out in a bad way.
Yeah, you always want to be authentic, whatever you're discussing or doing.
Mm-hmm. So the next issue that we want to address is Black female attorneys being harder on us than others.
So just to give a quick story of this, I've been in a situation where I was working for someone and I was directly reporting to the female attorney, and she was a Black female attorney at the firm. And I at times felt like she was harder on me or just expected more out of me than she did others. Even if we made the same mistakes, I might get a little bit more pushback than others. And obviously like that made me feel some type of way. It was something that I had to talk with others about. But what I didn't realize is that this black female attorney, she was just trying to prepare me for what's ahead. I don't know if you watched Scandal, but Papa Pope, who is who I think is all our Papa by now, he said we have to work twice as hard just to be half as good as they are. Is that how he quoted it? And I get that now. She was trying to be harder on me because she knew what was ahead.
I agree. I had a similar experience when I was an intern at the Federal Judicial Center in undergrad. I was working, reporting to an attorney, and y'all, she was really, really hard on me. But I now know that she has had my best interests at heart. Even after I left, she wrote one of my letters of recommendation for law school, and she was able to speak very highly of me because she knew my work ethic, because she pushed me to explore that. Until this day, she still checks on me, you know, how are you doing? Why didn't you apply for this job? Like, what's your future looking like? And she wants to know those things, and it's because she's being hard on me, because honestly she loved me and wanted the best for me. So it's very important to, you know, make those connections, but don't feel bad when they're wanting more from you than they're wanting from others. They want more for you. And so the next issue that we want to cover is being overly humble and just like not demanding what we're really worth.
So to give a quick example of this, as pre-law students, right, you know, let's say we're working so hard to get that law school acceptance letter and it finally comes. Okay, we have some people who get that law school acceptance letter and they call the school like, hey, I got my law school acceptance letter. What can y'all offer me? You know, how much financial aid? I need more scholarship money because these schools over here are offering this, or I know I'm a good candidate. Like, what can y'all do for me? And then you have us, when we get our acceptance letter, it's like, oh my God, thank you guys so much. I'm like, whatever you guys offer me, I will accept it. Like, just just I'm just happy to be here. And that's a great attitude to have, but at the same time, you don't have to take what's just given to you. If you know you work your butt off, if you got a really good LSAT score, your GPA is high, you should be getting the same thing that they're getting offered. And a lot of times it's just us speaking up and making a counter offer. Okay, I see you guys offered me $3,000 a year in scholarship, but I need at least $15,000 to really commit to this school. Things like that. So don't be afraid to ask for what you're worth.
Mm-hmm. And honestly, don't accept the first thing that comes your way. So if you get, you know, your first law school acceptance, don't pay that deposit right away. If you apply for 7 schools, wait to hear back from all 7 of those schools before you make that decision, because at the end of the day, there may very well be a better opportunity out there for you. And if you just accept the first thing that comes your way, then you'll never be granted the opportunity to explore those other options that were available.
And going off of that, so let's say, for example, the first school you heard from, their seat deposit is due by April 15th, and you still haven't heard back from the other law schools that you are equally as interested in. You can ask that school if you pay that seat deposit, and if you down the line want to accept their offer, will they refund you for that seat deposit that you paid? All they can say is no. I know some schools are currently doing that. So just to recap that a little, you get accepted into one school and their due date is approaching. So you pay that seat deposit, and then later on, law school B and C accept you. And you're like, okay, great. Well, I already paid this seat deposit. Are you guys willing to refund that for me?
And we want to talk about some of the benefits that are available for us as Black women in the legal field. There are so many programs, scholarships, jobs available to us just because we are African American women. Mm-hmm. And I know a lot of people say this, you know, like being an African American woman, you're like 2 checks.
Yep.
So not only are you Black, but you're also a woman. So that's like 2 diversity checks. So that alone just shows you how you can benefit from being a Black woman. But more importantly, there's so many scholarships available for diverse applicants. So recently I just applied for a BALSA scholarship, and you have to be a member of BALSA, the Black Law Students Association, to apply for this scholarship. And I also applied for, I participated in the Minority and Diversity Clerkship Program. And this is how I got my summer job. So they were looking for,
yes, I have a job, y'all.
We got a video coming soon about that. I'm going to talk all about it. But yes, it was for minorities and diversity. So that's what they're looking for. They were looking for me. They were looking for someone, you know, who was diverse. And so it does benefit you to be a Black woman. I promise y'all. It's hard, but there are benefits.
And there's various organizations that were created just for us. So for those that are considering law school in the Georgia area, please, please, please consider the Georgia Association of Black Women Attorneys. This organization has become my family, has become my mentors, has become my big sister, has just connected me in so many ways with others that understand what I'm trying to do with my legal career. And through that organization, for example, I received the Gabawah Scholarship 1 year. I also am a member of the Gate City Bar Association. So I would definitely join those organizations. And when I joined Gate City, a short while later, I got the Gate City Judicial Bar Scholarship. So there's so many benefits. We have so much value to add to this legal community. So take your value and use it for what it's worth.
Yes, y'all. So if you're interested in other programs, if you need help finding some minority scholarships, I know Jazz got y'all.
Yes,
she will definitely help you. On Instagram at @LiveLaughLaw_. I just made a new Instagram dedicated solely to Live Laugh Law. So that's the future, the direction we're headed in for the future.
Yes, and you can follow us at Jazz Talks Law, JASTALKS Law, LAW. Very simple. And we are just launching our website, and we have some great, great things in store. So please check that out for more information about me being your law school coach, which is what you need to get through this law school admissions process. And you can even get our free law school admissions timeline by subscribing to our weekly email. So visit our website, www.jazztalkslaw.com.
And part two is coming soon. Thanks, y'all.
Bye.